Welcome, everybody. Welcome to the show. We're starting off with, what did we call it? My side of the Rory? My side of the Albanese. I'm calling Rory. He said he had things to talk about in reference to this podcast. So I'm calling him now. You can hear that shit?
Hello?
Hi, it's me, Hi. Sarah.
Hi, Sarah.
I'm your lover.
What?
You heard me.
Oh, I didn't know what Sarah I was talking to. Hi.
Huh. Hi, you're on the air. I feel I'm supposed to, like, legally tell you that.
Oh, but that word, I'm being recorded right now?
Yeah, that's right. You're being recorded right now. Huh?
You gotta open with that. You gotta open with that, you know? Start with all the other shenanigans.
Well, I go a different way with it.
I like that.
You do?
Yeah, it's nice. But, you know, it's probably not good on air to not talk. So, let me just say this. I wanted to talk to you this week because I listened, as I try to do every week, I listened to last week's podcast.
Yeah.
And, you know, and being honest, I do miss them from time to time. I do my best to stay abreast of all you're discussing.
I mean, no pressure. You get plenty of me.
I get it off the tap.
Just a real quick left turn. What are you wearing right now?
What am I wearing right now? I'm wearing a pair of shorts and a t-shirt.
I bet they're pretty short.
Why was it? What are you thinking I might be wearing?
I just wanted to hear about your short shorts.
Do you think they're too short?
No, I just, you know, I think the audience likes to be able to imagine what they're hearing right now. Like, were you lying on a couch? You're in some shorts, some loose shorts.
I'm sitting outside, but now I walk back inside with a very cute dog who's got a little cone on her head.
Did you find the cone?
I did. I found a soft cone.
How does she seem? Because we've been using a donut. Mary got a skin tag removed. I don't know if I told you guys about this. We originally thought it was a tick. So we're like pulling at it, saturating it with rubbing alcohol, pulling. And before I really yanked it, I went, is this definitely a tick? It wasn't. It was a skin tag. So, we
didn't hurt her. She was okay. She's extremely well cared for.
She didn't make a noise.
I took her hiking today and I put a little Band-Aid on her butt. It's so cute. She's got just a Band-Aid and a cone on her head. It's very cute. She doesn't seem to mind it. The donut is almost like a pillow for her. It's like you said, it was a reward.
I prefer the donut over cone, but yes, this morning I found her outside and one of her legs was through the donut and she was just standing three-legged, silent, didn't yelp, didn't call for help. I had to look everywhere to even find her. She's so weird.
She's stoic.
She's stoic.
But I'm hanging with her now, so I just don't want her to get her paw caught again, so I'm just kind of keeping an eye on her. But this little soft cone is good. Anyway, I'm wearing a very tight ribbed V-neck.
Ooh.
It's cropped, you know, it comes just above my my belly button. And I'm wearing shorts that I made out of old corduroys that I cut real, real short. Yeah.
Ooh. Where you really have to choose a side.
Well, I like hiking in corduroys so that coyotes don't come.
Oh, because they're like, veen.
Exactly. Exactly. It warns all predators that Mary and I are approaching.
That's really smart.
Yeah.
I love you in a crop top. Actually, I have a picture of you I'd like to post during this where you're wearing my t-shirt that I finally found because it was actually at your house. The tushy.com one that says, ask me about my butthole. Looked really hot on you, and I have a picture of it. We'll post it here. Okay,
really? So, I find it hard to believe that looks good.
It looked
good.
Yeah,
couple things I wanted to discuss. First of all, something that caught me off guard last week was you played a game of fuck Mary and she Chelsea Handler replaced kill with something else.
Right,
essentially,
yes.
Fuck Mary kill with Matt Gaetz, Mitch McConnell, and Lindsey Graham.
Yeah, I feel I answered that prudently.
I thought you did a terrible job at that. And generally speaking, I wouldn't say this because I'm, you know, pretty eye to eye on things, but you picked Matt Gaetz as the guy to fuck. And man, was that a poor choice?
Why was that
a poor choice? Because there's, you know, remember the old riddle when you were a kid about like there, you have on one side of a river like a sack of oats, a sheep, and a wolf. And you can't leave the sheep with the wolf because the wolf will eat the sheep. And you can't leave the sheep with the oats because and you have to figure out how to get them all across the river, but you only have one spot in a rowboat. You have to, like, there's a science to it. So,
okay.
Like, the answer is you marry Mitch McConnell because he goes to bed early and he's probably not going to be your husband for very long.
Yes, that's what I chose.
Right.
You say it was a mistake to say fuck Matt Gaetz.
Yes, a huge mistake because the trick here is you pick fuck Lindsey Graham because he's not going to do it. And then you're off the hook.
Ooh. I mean, that's an interesting point. I think you're making an assumption that he's not going to do it.
No, I'm right. He's not going to do it. And I also think, why would you ever want Matt Gaetz to know that you would even consider having sex with him? It's such a win for Matt Gaetz.
Yeah, I just figured it was the shortest possible amount of time to spend with someone. Now I have to go to temple. Now I have to go to church with him every week for a year.
Yeah, but at least I don't have to talk to him. You know, I mean, first of all, yeah, I don't know if you talk in church. I don't know what kind of church you know you'd be going to, but
a Jewish church.
If it's a Jewish church, there's no talking. Yeah. There's no joy.
No,
it's not like it's not like anything fun happens. I don't know. I just would never want that case to think, oh, cool, Sarah Silverman would have sex with me, you know? It's just the thought of him even potentially hearing that just bothers me.
I understand and I do hear you, Rory, but, I mean, just to point out, I did say I would, if suicide was an option, I would take that.
I understand, but it wasn't an option, so I thought I the system better than you did. That's all I'm saying.
Yeah, you thought this out. I appreciate that. I would like to amend, and this isn't just because the man told me to change it. I agree. I think that's a really good point.
That's it. It's just the fact that Matt Gaetz may have heard that podcast and been like, yeah. You know, it's just, ugh.
So feel he did not hear the podcast.
I forgot. I don't know what the last thing you said to me was, but I was going to refer to one other thing you mentioned about me last week, which was my new love of Barbra Streisand.
Uh-huh.
And I think that what you missed about that song, Guilty, which I think people should really know about, is it's a great song, but there is a little bit of a, you know, and maybe you're not picking up on this because maybe you're playing into it, but there's a little bit of a liberal agenda being dished in that song. You know?
Really?
And yeah, because there's a whole big government thing happening. She's actually saying that we should make it a crime to be lonely or sad. It ought to be illegal. You know? And I think that's a red flag to me that Streisand was out there for 30, 40 years pumping that liberal agenda.
Right. Now, it's on its surface, it sounds beautiful. It ought to be illegal to be lonely or sad. But really, when you think about it, it means that if you're lonely or sad, you have to go to jail.
Go to jail. This would be a lonely or sad.
I mean, that doesn't sound like a liberal agenda.
I feel like that's why Trump won.
Well, I know I just saw you about 25 minutes ago, and now I'm talking to you, and then I'll probably see you a little later, but I miss you.
No, I doubt that. I'm not guaranteed.
Oh, wait, no. You have plans tonight.
I do have plans tonight.
You are going. Go on.
Yeah. No, I'm going to Sushi Fumi, the restaurant where those Jewish people got jumped. So if anybody, I'm a Jew, so if anybody wants to come jump me outside Sushi Fumi, I'll be there tonight.
Yeah, anyone want to jump half a Jew? Sushi Fumi tonight. Come and get him, because he's ready.
Come on by.
He's ready.
I'm wearing a tight ribbed tee. You can't miss me.
He's wearing a ribbed half shirt and some cut off cords, and he's so fucking ready to fight.
Bring it. Bring it. Bring it.
Okay, darling.
All right, there, killer. All right, I hope this was a fun call. You know, it's very difficult calling in your podcast. It feels very much like just bombing. You know, there's just nothing but dead air on the other end of the phone.
Oh, you are. You're bombing. I mean, I'm looking at five faces through the glass, and they're just dead. They're just dead inside. Yeah. They just look like they're listening to, an AP wire on a slow day.
That's good. And if there's one thing I have my 10,000 hours in, it's bombing. I've mastered it.
Okay, my darling.
All right.
Have a great
podcast.
Tender feelings for you. We don't have to make it into a big deal.
I appreciate that. I have tender feelings for you as well.
Here's some ads.
Breaking news. This important PSA is brought to you by Manscaped.com. This is your pubic service announcement. Get it? This is your pubic service announcement. And the news you've all been waiting for. The Manscaped engineering team has confirmed that they have successfully created the Lawnmower 4.0 trimmer, which is now available for purchase in the USA and Canada. This new trimmer was just released only moments ago, and we are one of the first to get our hands on it and share the news. Ladies, this is the perfect gift for you and your man. Join over 2 million men worldwide who trust Manscaped with this exclusive offer for you. 20% off and free worldwide shipping with the code Sarah at manscaped.com. I gave Rory this trimmer, but I'll be honest, I like his bush full. No problem. He uses it. He puts it on like a longer setting. Then it's just right, you know? A little trimmed for him, not so trimmed for me. One of my favorite features on the Lawnmower 4.0 is the 400K LED spotlight that helps for those more precise shaves. I also love that it gives men the ability to customize their trim all over through additional guard lengths with sizes 1-4. That's what I'm talking about. Get 20% off and free shipping with the code Sarah at manscaped.com. That's 20% off with free shipping at manscaped.com and use code Sarah. Make sexy time the best time with Manscaped. Tushy, tushy, tushy. Water. The latest in butt cleaning technology. Hello Tushy's brand new 3.0 modern bidet attachment is stylish, eco-friendly, easy to install, and even saves your cheap-ass money. Hello Tushy 3.0 doesn't just clean your butt with a precise stream of fresh water, it cleans itself with the Smart Spray automatic nozzle. Hello Tushy attaches to your existing toilet, no electricity or extra plumbing needed, cutting toilet paper use by 80%, paying for itself in just a few months. I love Hello Tushy. My sister has Hello Tushy. She swears by it. I am a bidet woman. I don't like to even leave the bathroom unless my vagina and asshole are immaculate, up to 3 inches deep. Hello Tushy has your ass covered with a 60-day risk-free guarantee and a 12-month warranty. Go to HelloTushy.com/Sarah to get 10% off plus free shipping. This is a special offer for Sarah Silverman podcast listeners only. Go to HelloTushy.com/Sarah for 10% off. HelloTushy.com/Sarah. Because when you think of your asshole, you think of me.
And we're back.
I'm going to continue with this podcast. I'm sorry. I'm a little, excited. I get my boyfriend on the phone. Hi, everybody. So, yes, that was Rory. That was fun. Isn't he just delicious? I wanted to talk about something I saw this week in my own YouTube algorithm that popped up. Here's the thing. Every few years, a man I don't know and who does not know me becomes just extremely interested in how I live my life. Most recently, it's this dude.
It's time for some free public education once again for feminists. This is something that I've had a lot of success with in helping women unlearn some of the toxic negative beliefs from feminists that are keeping them lonely, single, unmarried, and childless, like actress Sarah Silverman.
Oh my God, I can't wait to learn, and for free. It's for free. And from a renowned patriarchal marriage coach, which I'm sure takes, you know, extensive training and research to achieve. And it's just so weird that, why do they give a fuck, these people? I remember I was emailing with Gavin McInnes, who, you know, he started the Proud Boys. And this is another story for another time, or maybe no time at all. But anyway, the short story is he used to be comedy community adjacent way back when, and we were all friendly. And then he started the Proud Boys, so a lot of us know him, oddly. And, you know, Proud Boys actually define themselves as anti-feminist. It's an anti-feminist movement. Again, why do you care? So anyway, he was telling me how feminism has ruined my life. He was explaining to me how I'm ruined by feminism. And he was like, on Valentine's Day, you tweeted that you don't need a man because you smelled your armpit and you already smelled like a man. And I was like, how are you aware of my tweets? I couldn't in a million years recollect tweeting that. I'm sure I did tweet it, because it is true. Sometimes after I work out, I have that like smell I love on men, and I produce it myself, you know, when I get my sweat on. But why on earth does he give a fuck? It's so odd, but it just keeps coming up in my life. So I have to assume it's coming up in other women's lives that there are men out of nowhere having extreme opinions about how we choose to like think and live our lives. Anyway, also like again, another example, like a few years ago, some Orthodox rabbi wrote an open letter about how I need to stop being political and I need to get married and have children to like understand what the, you know, life really is about for a woman. And I would have never even seen it, but my dad, who needless to say has a Google alert on my name, saw it and responded in classic schleppy style, and it got like picked up everywhere. And then there was this pastor in Florida who posted his sermon on YouTube. I'm not going to like bring attention to it, but, you know, he, in his sermon on YouTube, he told his congregation that knocking my teeth out and killing me would be God's work because I'm a Jew witch. Maybe that's a little off topic. And yet, is it? Okay. Anyway, here's the latest. This yogi Oab, whatever his name is, bro, is very troubled by me and my personal choices. Let's play another clip.
And you have to wonder, how do women get to this place? So I want to take you back in time to several years ago. She was on the Jimmy Kimmel show, and Jimmy Kimmel looked through her purse, and then he found this.
It doesn't matter.
All right.
Oh, look at these.
Those are condoms.
Yes.
Give them to homeless people before they have sex with me.
This is a shameless woman.
It's so funny that he thinks a talk show bit is real. How is he an expert again? And on what exactly? I mean, the fucking labias on this guy. It was a bit on a talk show. And even if it was true, it's just very odd. Okay, let's see a little more.
Now, we all know that logic may not always be a woman's strong suit, so I just want to very briefly break down the science behind this, because if you're a feminist and you're already anti-Christian and anti-God, you shouldn't also be anti-science. So Sarah believes in hooking up with strangers, and she's an actress, she's a career woman, she's got her own podcast, She also doesn't believe in gender. These types of women are single, unmarried, because they're not even connected to who they are as women. American women today are man repellents because there's too much masculinity and confusion inside of them. And that's ultimately the work of the devil.
Oh, there's the science, the devil. Thank you. Thank you. He's really breaking it down in a way that I can, now I can understand. Yeah. Do we have anything else? Is there more?
So that's it for the free education today on how to stop being a crazy feminist. So I hope Sarah Silverman sees this and really wakes up, because the stuff coming out of her mouth is beyond insane. So let me know what you guys think below in the comments. And until next time, keep it classy.
Keep it classy. Yes, please keep it classy. So Yogi, I did see it. Thank you so much. You've really changed me. I didn't realize that my freedom and independence was the work of the devil, but I am going to tell Rory, you know what I need? I think a spanking. I think just a very hard, stern spankaroony. Get all that feminism out of me. All right. Should I take this seriously at any point? No. But what do these men have in common? I was just like, well, what do these men have in common? Because this, why does this keep happening? I would guess, if I were a guessing man, that this is what happens when you have an existential crisis because of the progress happening around you or whatnot, but you are unable to look inward. Your pain, your confusion, it has to be someone else's fault. It's got to be someone's fault. Your survival depends on it. Your survival depends on this being the fault of someone or something out there outside of yourself. So it's got to be feminism, I mean. But it's just so funny because feminism is one of those words that people have different definitions for, but all it means is equality. It's just equality. That's all it means, equality. And that equality threatens his understanding of his place in the world for some reason. I don't know why he gives an actual fuck, but he has no choice but to peddle this concept of there needs to be boys and girls and patriarchy and women who know their place. He is having a crisis of existence, and he is addressing it by buying a pipe and deciding he's a professor. Oh, buddy, you are fine just the way you are. Look at you. I have literally nothing to do with your life. For all you know, I don't even exist. We're brains in jars, and I'm just part of your narrative. You know, maybe take a psychedelic and find yourself. Look at you. You're handsome. You wear a collared shirt well. You're well kempt. Kempt. That's a real word, kempt. You're winning. You got this. I just can't imagine why these men are just so disturbed by just me over here living my life. But who knows? Hey, Rory, you have any comments on this? Because I'm going to move on to voicemails.
No, I think you're right. I think that, you know, look. I grew up.
Oh, am I right? Do you think I'm right, man?
Well, listen. Let me justify your lady thoughts by saying they're correct. Is that fair?
Thank you so much.
Let me give you a man thumbs up. But no, you know this about me. Like, I grew up in the toxic masculine world, and you have to deprogram yourself on that stuff. And I'm only the last few years being. That been thrown in my face, and am I learning about it? And like, this dude, the problem is this, is like, if the world that you live in only works only works if people like you don't exist, if women with independent thoughts and ideas don't exist. Otherwise, the whole paradigm that they're living in is broken. So they don't know what to do. And so, like you said, instead of looking inward and going, you know, maybe I got to make some adjustments here, you know, they do the opposite, which is lash out at you. You know, I'm not a fan of giving these guys any oxygen, but what's amazing about you is you'll probably, like, end up, like, you know, teaching him and, like, keep him a hug. I would rather him just meet me at Sushi Fumi tonight, you know, after a California roll. But, you know, I think that you're totally right, and I think that the internet is, like, rife with these guys who are holding on to, you know, something that they think is what makes the world make sense, you know, and they can't let go of it. And so, it's, you know, it is sad in some ways. I'm at a point now where there's just too many morons out there to care about all.
I know. But the world is such a scary place for guys like this, for, you know.
Yeah.
And, you know, what he doesn't realize is all of us develop, either are taught or develop survival skills to get through childhood, to be able to make sense of this world and to just survive. But as adults, it's our job to unlearn those things that no longer serve us. But he can't bear the thought to unlearn those things. Those things are what he's based his whole world on. And it's scary when that falls apart, that house of cards, you know.
Yep, it is. I don't know.
It's not very brave to do a dissertation on how a stranger you don't know is living her life wrong. It's a little more brave to look at your own shit. But, you know.
Yeah, but he's not going to do that. He's gonna do his podcast, say dumb shit, go to the gym, and then go to the Izod store. That's that guy's week.
The Izod store.
And I shouldn't have dragged Izod into this. That wasn't right.
Come on, I grew up in New Hampshire. It was a big Izod town, very L.L. Bean.
That's fair. Well, listen, I think your feminism is what's ruining the world, but I dare you. You know, I can get over it.
I appreciate that. I appreciate your honesty.
Yeah. All right, well, have a great rest of your podcast. I'm going to go listen to some Streisand and just get some things done over here.
It ought to be illegal listening to that song.
That's what ought to be illegal. That's what Babs should have been thinking about.
All right, baby. Talk to you later.
Right. See you later. Bye.
Here's some ads.
Policy Genius. All right, we're almost halfway through the year. Head into June with one less thing to worry about. See if you're overpaying for home and auto insurance. Policy Genius makes it easy to compare home and auto insurance in one place. They can help you find coverage similar to what you have now, but at a lower price. They've saved shoppers up to $1,055 per year over what they were paying for home and auto insurance. Their team will handle the paperwork to set up your new policy or switch over your current one. It's so low effort. Why wouldn't you just give Policy Genius a shot? Just head to policygenius.com, answer a few quick questions about yourself and your property, and boom. Then Policy Genius takes it from there, comparing rates from America's top insurers, from Progressive to Allstate, to find your lowest quotes. Head to policygenius.com to get started right now. Policy Genius. When it comes to insurance, it's nice to get it right. Ah, Headspace. Who couldn't use a little life improvement? Whether it's improving sleep, helping with focus, or reducing overwhelm, Headspace can help. Headspace is your daily dose of mindfulness in the form of guided meditations in an easy-to-use app. It's one of the only meditation apps advancing the field of mindfulness and meditation through clinically validated research. Headspace has a 3-minute SOS meditation for you if you're stressed. If you can't sleep, Headspace has wind down sessions their members swear by. And for parents, Headspace even has morning meditations you can do with your kids. I can tell you from personal experience that getting quiet and doing a guided meditation changes everything. Looking inward is the shit. Meditation and just getting quiet, All this stuff is so helpful, and I love it. Headspace is backed by 25 published studies on its benefits, 600,000 five-star reviews, wow, and over 60 million downloads. Headspace makes it easy for you to build a life-changing meditation practice with mindfulness that works for you, on your schedule, anytime, anywhere. You deserve to feel happier, and Headspace is meditation made simple. Go to headspace.com/Silverman. That's headspace.com/Silverman for a free 1 month trial with access to Headspace's full library of meditations for every situation. This is the best deal offered right now. So head to headspace.com/Silverman today.
And we're back.
Well, here we go. Why don't we start listening to some voicemails?
You left me a message. Now I'm playing it for the world. Let's hear some voicemails.
Sarah, actually, we got some friends, some activity on the friends line this week.
Very exciting. Who do we got?
Sarah, there's something on your podcast that's really Susie. Been bothering me, and I'm sorry, but I just have to call you on it. Liquid IV. I mean, isn't all IV liquid? I mean, shouldn't it be called drinkable IV? Also, I got new Crocs.
Well, this was definitely a misdirect, because I talked about Israel last week, and, you know, we see one eye to one eye. But that's hilarious. I love you, Rabbi Susie. And that's a really good point. Liquid IV. All IV is liquid. I've never heard of a chunky IV or a, you know, lumpy or thick or solid IV. So great tip for our often sponsor Liquid IV. Drinkable IV. Think about it. So dumb. What else?
Hi, it's Renee Taylor. I heard Sarah say about the nanny. I played the mother, and I know a lot of people think I'm English. They get me confused with a lot of English people, but I could say that the Renee Taylor is really Jewish. And Sarah could say that. I love her. Bye.
First of all, I'm so excited that Renee Taylor called in. And it's funny because I think it was like the week before last, we had Betty call in, who had never met a Jew. And she discovered the nanny and fell in love with like Jewishness. And she said on it, when I was listening back, I was frustrated because she said, you know, I don't know if the other characters are Jewish. And I was like, you know, condescendingly, like, no, the other characters aren't Jewish. They're like aristocratic. It's a fish out of water show. But of course, Renee Taylor played the nanny's mother and of course was Jewish. And that snagged on me when I listened back. And it's so funny. It's amazing that she called. That is so cool she called in. And of course she's Jewish. It's got to be true. Nobody lies about being Jewish. She must have changed her name, though, Renee Taylor. But she's from a time where you really can't have a career in show business if you have a Jewish name or are outwardly Jewish. Fuck, I'm from that time. Renee Taylor is fascinating. You know, I think she's mostly known. I would say she's almost entirely known by people today as the nanny's mother on The Nanny. But she was a comedian and an actress and a singer and a writer, an Oscar-nominated writer. She was a comedian in the 50s. Bring it back to Barbara Streisand. Barbara Streisand used to open for her. She was in the original The Producers movie, Mel Brooks movie, The Producers. She was, like I said, she was nominated for an Academy Award for writing a screenplay called Lovers and Other Strangers that she co-wrote. And continue to read. She wrote a lot of scripts and was nominated for a WGA award on another screenplay the following year called Made for Each Other. So that's just a little info on Renee Taylor, who called into this show to make a very keen and important correction. And thank you, Renee Taylor. All right, what else?
Hey, Sarah. This is Hugh calling from the North Shore.
Hugh.
So far up the North Shore that people use wicked as an adverb, like I wicked had a great time at the party. Or use doesn't to mean does, like Martha has to sign that document and so doesn't John.
Yes.
Anyway, I had a comment and a question. thank you for your little piece on Guilty a few episodes ago. It's been ricocheting around my head now that I've listened to it 19 times in a row.
I can't believe how powerful this moment of the song
Guilty. There are parts of the song that are pretty meaningless and just sort of rom-com song nonsense, like Highways to the Sky. But I think the song is really about infidelity, and that might be obvious, but where it kind of breaks open, I think, is in the line, you battle on with either the love you're building on or the love you're living on. And that's probably why Sir Gibb, since he was recently knighted, talks about the fact that they're slipping around at night and think they're so grand. But since it's the 80s and since they're boomers, they've really got nothing to be guilty of. They're just going to get into their white satin clothes and shtup. I did have a question, though.
That's
in the first episodes of your show, the cookies in the show would always scream in pain when they were bitten. And I knew then that your series was genius. And I just wondered who came up with that idea that the cookies on the cookie show were going to scream in pain.
Great.
Thanks.
Question. All right. This is twofold. Of course, let's start with Guilty. Very interesting interpretation, slightly different from Rory's. But yes, this is an 80s song, quintessential 80s song, because they're saying we're both in relationships, but we need to be beholden to our love and we're in love. So fuck everything. Fuck the people who are going to get hurt. We shouldn't feel guilty because love is beautiful and we're in the motherfucking me generation. I'm swearing too much. Sorry. That's interesting. So he's talking about the Sarah Silverman program, which was a show I had on Comedy Central. And within that show was a show called Cookie Party that we all loved. And it was hosted, Cookie Party was hosted by Rob Schraub, who co-created the show and directed most of the episodes. What was her name on that? I don't remember. But I don't think he came up with the cookies being hurt. I'll tell you who did. All the cookie stuff and all the animated stuff was created by a young Justin Roiland, who you may know as the creator of a little show called Rick and Morty. He went on to create Rick and Morty and do so much, and he's brilliant. But on the Sarah Silverman program, he played a nerd on camera. He was a friend of Stephen Bryan's. And he did all our web content and a lot of animated stuff and was in charge of the cookie party stuff. So that was all him. And his first pass at the cookie party song, I still feel guilty about, because I was like, it sounds weird. It's like scary. And like his girlfriend at the time sang it and I made him change it. Or maybe I got talked into leaving it. I hope I did. I don't really remember. But anyway, very proud that Justin Roiland came from the Sarah Silverman program. And that's who came up with the cookies being in terrible pain as people bit into them. Hope that answers your question. What else?
I should clarify. So what's the last time you were really glad you were wrong about something, insofar as you were really glad it could be a person, that you were happy and relieved that they didn't turn out to be as bad as they were, or it could be an idea where it ended up changing your mindset. But what do you think that changed your mindset like that?
Well, this isn't the last time at all, but there are a couple things that come to mind. And this first one is old, but popped up recently. After my first special, Jesus is Magic, in which there's a lot of race stuff in it, and I got one very bad review, and it was from A.O. Scott of the New York Times. And I'm bringing it up because I just did what I thought was a podcast with him, but I guess they made it into an article. But anyway, I was able to talk to him in person, and it was nice because that terrible review was incredibly helpful to me. And what resonated with me in that review, the one thing that I've always remembered, was that he criticized me and kind of liberal comedians that, you know, and the fact that we kind of were acting like, hey, I'm not racist, so I can say racist things, you know? I'm liberal, so I can say the N-word, you know? And when he pointed that out, it really resonated with me, and it spun me out in a really good way. It changed me at from a molecular level. And it's funny because I looked at, you know, I was, you know, I'm a prepared person, and I reread the review before I did his podcast, and it was really interesting because, you know, I'm always like, well, comedy isn't evergreen, and of course, you know, certainly I've looked at old stuff I've done and cringed and apologized for it and have been changed by it, and I'm into that shit. But criticism, the art of criticism, too, is not evergreen. Because I read this review, and it was there were problematic things that he agreed with when I brought it up. You know, it was a really interesting conversation. You know, it's like, I think the nicest thing he said about me was that I was reasonably pretty. And also he said something that didn't cross my mind at the time, but I read in a new way as I read it again. He said, quote, like many Jewish comedians, Silverman falls back on her ethnic identity as a way of claiming ready-made outsider status, which I took him to task about when we talked recently, because would he ever say that about Black comics, Mexican comics, Asian comics, Muslim comics, any other kind of comic, you know, we all talk about the things that make us different. Because those are the things that make us the same, right? So to say a false way to claim outsider status is such a thoughtless perpetuation of anti-Semitism, the assumption that Jews are not to be worried about and do not merit allyship. You know, racism is defined by racists, not liberals, you know, and racists don't like Jews. Anyway, it was a really cool talk. We both were, you know, open, and it was just invulnerable, and I, you know, it was cool. It was very cool. You might want to check it out. They wrote it out. I thought it was a podcast. Maybe it's a podcast, but they also made an article about it. I don't know. But anyway, what else?
Hey, Sarah, it's Dickie from Los Angeles, and I'm calling in response to your porn MD, We Didn't Start the Fire Today, which was funnier than it should have been, I think. And I think the funniest of all of them, and there were a lot of funny ones, was Trouble in the Suez, delivered with all the urgency that Billy Joel delivered that with back in the day. I was wondering if you might want to try the porn
MD. It was like Gang Bang Threesome, Trouble in the
with
Suez.
R.E.M.'s End of the World as We Know It, which I think might be fun too. Love the show. Keep going.
It's the end of the world as we know it. Live search. Okay, I'm ready. Tushy anal threesome, first big dick cream pie. Homemade anal passion threesome, Latina MILF fisting, massage rooms, double anal porn 8-tube. Gangbang Asian, uncensored Korean sex, lesbian squirt, sloppy blowjob. Oh no, it goes again, sorry. Lesbian, sleepy, stepsister, blowjob, cum in mouth. Gangbang, cream pie, Japanese group, sex, erotic, massage, female orgasm, ebony squirt, double penetration, tiny tits, gay men fucking, Asian gangbang, Indian college girl. It's the end of the world as we know it. It's the end of the world as we know it. It's the end of the world as we know it. Glory hole cream pie. Massage room browsers, vixen, erotic sex, big boobs, best blowjob ever. Eating pussy, Russian browsers, threesome, lesbian fisting, dirty talk, hardcore lesbian scissoring, glory hole, amateur first big dick, deep throat compilation casting, mature threesome, ebony anal, amateur anal, virgin, lesbian fetish. It's the end of the world as we know it. It's the end of the world as we know it. Lesbian ass-licking world as we know it. Stepmom and stepson. I feel fine. I feel fine. Maybe one more time. Rough babysitter, huge tits, porn, mature HD, fuck my wife solo, extreme hardcore, anal pussy licking, double blowjob, BDSM, hardcore, public agent, stepsister, orgies, group sex, lesbian, hairy milf, bratty, stepsis, point of view, blowjob of the world. Oh wait, it keeps going. Alright, there are some real good ones in there. I'm impressed. What else is a, the Bob Dylan song, Subterranean Homesick Blues. Can we find that one? I'm trying to remember how that goes in real life. Something the government. I don't know if I'm going to be as good at this, but let's try it. Stepmother, threat mouth, Japanese fetish, teenage, sorry. Hardcore, rough, gang bang, horny, MILF, amateur, swingers, group sex, party, hairy pussy, prostate massage, blowjob, missionary cream pie, orgasm, erotic female domination, romantic sex, very big dick, wife threesome, chubby MILF, amateur group sex, teeny tiny lesbian threesome, cum in mouth compilation, ebony MILF, bondage, deep throat, college orgy, anime hentai, I don't know. Redhead MILF, squirting orgasm, caught masturbating, hot MILF, come inside, tie, lesbian seduction, stepfather, stepdaughter, stepdaddy, hardcore pussy eating, amateur blowjob, mature anal, come in mouth, cream pie compilation, cum fetish, natural big tits, Latina cream pie. All right. You know what? We should let this bit go, but it's so fun that I would say call in with more like listy songs that would be fun to do it to, because I gotta admit, I'm not proud of this, but it's really becoming my joy. Dad, we're winding down. I don't want to catch you by surprise. I know you've been through a lot, and I want you to just ease into the ending. That is the ending. What? That's not very clear. And I just want you to know, let's start over. Dad, we're winding down. I don't want to startle you. I don't want this ending to take you by surprise. But the podcast this week is over. I hope you liked it. And I love you so much. And to everybody else, please subscribe. Subscribe, rate, and review wherever you listen to podcasts. You hear that at the end of every podcast, but really subscribe because it keeps us on the air. And if you like watching with your eye holes, because really, all my magic is right here in the face, check us out on YouTube. Bye.
Hey, you fucker!